When I say Alpha Beta's having a beef sale, I mean a beef sale. We've cut the price on over 50 cuts of fine butcher's pride beef. Boneless rump roasts are just $1.69 a pound. T-bone and porterhouse steak just $2.49 a pound. And to give you even more for your money, Alpha Beta trims the fat. It's Alpha Beta's quarter-inch advantage. And all our fresh meats have a double your money back guarantee. So if you like beef and you like to save money, Alpha Beta's big beef sale is on. Tell a friend.
Finer than the taste of Aunt Jemima in the morning.
How about Aunt Jemima fixes you up with something toasty instead? New Aunt Jemima pancakes sound good? Then get your toaster. That's right. Aunt Jemima spent a lot of time sifting and whisking to make pancakes so good you wouldn't believe they came out of a toaster.
Nothing could be finer than the taste of Aunt Jemima in the morning.
You'll say, yeah, when you see the movie everybody loves.
Awesome.
Little Shop of Horrors, rated PG-13. Now play it.
Join the party on New Year's Eve with Charles Nelson Reilly, ex-prostitute Norma Jean, Almodovar, and pop singer Sylvester. It's going to be great.
Tonight at 11 on Channel 2. Tonight, pop your corn, pour your eggnog, and get ready to enjoy a really great Channel 2 presentation. In the beginning, before Graziano, Marciano, or Balboa, even before Sylvester Stallone, the original Rocky.
Yo, Bullwinkle!
Channel 2 presents 2 hours of interviews, episodes, and anecdotes.
Hooray!
It's Bullwinkle's New Year's Eve special. Tonight's special holiday presentation on Channel 2.
Today on the campus of a large Minnesota college, the University of Wasamata. Inside the administration building, an important meeting is taking place.
I don't want to alarm you, gentlemen, but it looks like disaster for Wasamata U.
What's a disaster?
What do you mean?
What a disaster?
What'd he say?
The chancellor said we're facing disaster.
Sing what?
Disaster!
I don't know the words. How about Camp Town races instead?
Gentlemen, unless we do something quickly, we will meet our doom.
What did he say?
Doom, doom, doom.
Camp Town ladies sing this song, doo-da, doo-da.
Please, this is no time for levity. Our enrollment has dropped 80%. Our buildings are crumbling away. And what's even worse?
Yes.
They're taking the Coke machine out of the faculty lounge.
Oh, horror. But why? Why?
The answer is simple, gentlemen. What does every successful university have that we don't have?
Well-heeled alumni?
Electric light?
The address of the Ford Foundation?
No, a successful football team.
Do we even have a football team?
Yes, Wasamata U did have a team of sorts, but it hadn't scored a goal in 22 years.
And it's time we did.
Oh, I don't know. Seems a shame to spoil a perfect record like that.
But Coach Rocky Canute had something to say about that.
I move we get the best football team money can buy.
Hear, hear! But how will we pay for it?
How else? We'll fire a few English teachers.
Yeah, who needs them? We all speak English already.
Some of us do, anyway.
You incinerating that I'm dumb?
That you what?
Dumb. Dump. Dump.
Going to run all night, going to run all day.
And so it was settled. 5 professors were sacked and 5 football scouts were hired.
All right, you guys, I want you to scour the city, comb the countryside, and especially beat the bushes.
Why beat the bushes?
The kind of fellas we want are probably living in them. Now, go on.
The scouts sought high and low for candidates for football glory. They poked into every nook and cranny in the state. A couple of them even went further than that. They got completely lost and as a result wound up in Frostbite Falls, where, as fate would have it, Rocket Squirrel chose that moment to say...
Gosh, Bullwinkle, I'm making a salami souffle and I'm all out of Whiffle powder.
Dad, this is fraught with portent.
What's fraught with portent?
This picture, see? There's Eddie Frost and George Portent. Nice fellers.
Bullwinkle, I gotta get down to the store and back before the salami souffle flops.
Stop snuffling and speak up.
Well, give me a hand, Bullwinkle.
Delighted.
Ah,
propelled by mighty moose muscle, Rocky Flash, clear to town, into the grocery store, and back before you can say, Jack Robinson!
Jack Robinson!
Here I am!
By golly, I couldn't have said.
Of course, all this hadn't gone unnoticed.
You know what this means, Chauncey?
Certainly, a fluffy souffle.
No, it means we found the football sensation of the year.
I think he's too furry for a football. And that tail.
Not the squirrel, the moose.
He's the wrong shape for a football.
But he's the right shape for a passer. Come on.
And the two scouts dashed into Bullwinkle, pen in hand.
Sign here, fella.
It's a college scholarship.
A scholarship?
Certainly. I can see at a glance your brainy.
Yeah.
Your intelligence.
Yeah.
Your brilliance.
Yeah.
Then why don't you sign?
I forget how to make a B.
Well, maybe he'll remember next time in a college for two or rock enrolls.
He's Dale Robertson speaking for... Got the wrong script on the teleprompter. As you know, this is really the Huntley Brinkley Report.
Bill Scott originally started announcing the show as a live-action puppet. And not only did he voice it, he was there with his hand up in the puppet working it.
I don't know. I don't think those cartoons capture the real me. Oh, I know I don't have the handsomest profile in the world, but you've got to admit, I've got more than anybody else. Oh, well. It's time for our weekly excursion into Elfsville to put a new twist on an old tale. In a nice way, of course. And here it comes, a fractured fairy tale.
Once upon a time, there was a king named Midas. He was a very greedy king indeed. The one thing he loved most in the world was...
gold!
The one thing he had the most of was...
gold!
And the one thing he wanted more of was...
gold! Gold! Gold!
So, he sent his tax collectors into the kingdom to do his gold gathering for him. As the people grew poorer and poorer from being taxed, Midas grew richer and richer. Finally, the people were reduced to living on a diet of turnips. As a result, King Midas began to get the funny feeling that people didn't like him very much.
I need to do something to make people like me. Then I can tax them even more.
So, the king called a meeting of his advisors, Bobble, Bangle, Bede, and Benson.
Gentlemen, I must be made popular.
Well, sire, I'm just talking off the top of my thatch.
What is it, Benson?
Well, what about lowering the taxes? We could... That wasn't it, huh?
The next day, the king called another meeting of his advisors, Bobble, Bangle, and Bede.
Well, let's put this idea on the rack, see how it stretches, KM. We'll point out your warm human qualities.
What warm human qualities?
Well, you must have some.
Like what?
Dogs. Everybody likes dogs.
I hate dogs!
I can see it now. Heralds all over the kingdom, posters on every wall. Midas loves mutts.
Hear ye, hear ye! This day, King Midas will free all dogs in the royal dog pound!
Sure enough, as the people watched, the king let all the dogs loose.
Maybe he's not all bad. Animals like him.
Your Majesty, would you like to pet Tweaky here?
Oh, how nice! A lovely pussycat! Pussycat!
And the king was instantly buried in a snarling mass of dogs.
Get off, you mutts! Get off! Oh, I hate dogs!
Just as I thought, a fake.
And the people once more pelted the king with turnips. Before, they had just disliked him. Now, they despised him. So the next day, Midas called another meeting of his advisors, Bobble and Bangle.
All right, now what?
Well, let's put this in a crossbow and see how it shoots. Midas, you'll slay a dragon.
Me?
You.
Ooh. Good! Hear ye, hear ye! King to fight dragon!
Maybe there's something good about Midas after all.
Well, on the appointed day, King Midas rode forth to do battle with the fire-breathing dragon, which, of course, wasn't a real dragon at all.
Herbert, foul fiend!
Unfortunately, as Midas swung, the head flew off his axe and felled a nearby tree.
Another fake!
So the people again let fly with turnips. By now, they didn't just despise the king, they actually hated him. Next day, the king called a meeting of his advisor, Bobble.
Well, Bobble, what now?
Well, sire, let's just throw this in the moat, see if it floats. What about giving you the golden touch?
Isn't that expensive?
Well, not if you just use this spray gun and this cheap gold paint.
Good thinking, Bravo.
The word spread in a flash.
King has gold touch. Midas 24 carat monarch. Big free demonstration.
People came from all over to watch the king turn things into gold. Hats, canes, bushes, even rocks.
That's gold?
Looks like gold.
Yeah.
Feels like gold.
Yeah.
The king says it's gold.
Yeah.
It's gold.
Hooray for King Midas!
Well, the king sprayed more and more things until everything in the kingdom looked as if it were made of gold. Midas, of course, was very popular, but since everybody had more make-believe gold than he could use, gold began to lose its value. Soon, it took a wheelbarrow full of gold just to buy one turnip. But back in his castle, the king was very happy indeed.
Bobble, you've done it. The people like me, and I'm still the richest man in the kingdom.
Not quite, sire.
Huh?
The country has gone off the gold standard.
What? Well, what is the standard now?
Turnips.
Turnips?
Yes, turnips it was. And, of course, everybody had some turnips. Everybody except King Midas. With nothing but gold, he was the poorest man in his own kingdom.
You mean I'm broke, Bobble?
Looks like, sire.
So the next day, the king called a meeting of his advisors. And, of course, nobody was there but him. Today, King Midas lives in a very modest castle on a little side street. He still has lots and lots of friends. And, of course, he still has the golden touch.
And now...
Hey, Rocky! Watch me pull a rabbit out of my hat.
Again?
Nothing up my sleeve. Presto! Ooh, don't know my own strength.
Now here's something we hope you'll really like.
Hello there, poetry lovers. Today's poem is a saga of the sports world entitled Jack Be Nimble. Jack Be Nimble, Jack Be Quick. Jack Jump Over the Cat.
Hold it, Moose.
Who are you?
Allow me to introduce myself. Nimble's the name. Jack B. Nimble.
Nimble?
My card.
High Jumps Incorporated. Candlewick's a specialty.
You're sorry.
Well, I sort of thought of jumping over this one myself.
Yourself? You got union card?
What union?
Local 89, Hop, Skip, and Jumpers Union.
Well, no.
You jump over that thing and we'll snuff out every candle in town.
Okay, you do it.
No, you talking.
Jack be nimble, Jack be quick, Jack jump over the candle wick.
Ta-da! That'll be $40.
$40? How come?
Minimum wage law.
Minimum wage law?
Certainly. Minimum wage is $1 an hour.
So?
So obviously I get $40 a week.
I had been working very hard at Disney's and Warner Brothers and MGM. I had been doing animation for a long time, and Jay had heard about me. And my agent called me one day and said, do you know a guy named Jay Ward? And I said, I've never heard of him in my life. I'd never even heard of Crusader Rabbit. I'd heard of Disney and Warner's, but that was about all. So Jay took me to lunch one day, and over a double martini lunch, I was ready to accede to anything. And that's how he invited me onto the show. I didn't have to voice test or anything, and it was just a dream all the way down the line.
Last time you remember, the trustees of Wassamata U were wondering how to keep their college from going bankrupt.
How about giving an honorary degree to Danny Warbucks?
You ninny, he's only a make-believe character.
We're real?
In the end, of course, they followed the lead of so many other colleges, they decided to get a winning football team. As a result, two scouts are trying to sign a Bullwinkle.
Bullwinkle, you know who these fellas are?
Pick and Pat?
No.
Gallagher and Sheen?
No.
Null and Void? Fair and Wormy?
No, they're scouts.
If they're scouts, let's see them rub two sticks together.
They're football scouts.
Then let's see them rub two footballs together.
Let's check the little old rule book, Edgar. Uh-oh.
Trouble?
Says here we can enroll anybody except a moose.
Let me see that. Oh, Chauncey, that doesn't say moose.
No,
That's Mouse.
Hot diggity!
Come on, sign.
Okay.
X? Bowwinkle, you know how to spell your name.
Yeah, but I don't want to look like a show-off.
That's
Humble,
not...
that's me.
Yeah, but...
Mr. Modesty.
But...
When it comes to humility, I'm the greatest.
So I see.
And so it came to pass that a few days later, Bullwinkle Moose arrived on the campus of What's the Matter You?
It's like a beautiful dream, Rock. There must be a catch in it somewhere.
You sure you got everything, Bullwinkle?
Well, let's see. I'm wearing my bell-bottom trousers and three-tone shoes.
Yeah.
I got my ukulele and my hair stickum.
Uh-huh. Do you have your textbooks?
Don't bother me with details, Rock.
Mr. Moose, I'm your counselor. Now, about your classes.
I just wear them to read.
No, your classes.
I gotta go to classes?
Of course.
I told you there was a catch in it somewheres.
Now, I'd suggest you take Introduction to Chemical Kinetics, Differential Calculus, and the History of the Peloponnesian Wars.
Take them? I can't even pronounce them.
Boy, they sound tough.
I'll never have time to play football.
Oh, you're a football player?
The frostbite falls flush. Want to see my clippings?
From your last game?
No, from my last haircut.
It won't be necessary. You'll take the regular classes for an athletic scholarship.
Which are?
Personal grooming, crocheting, and reading modern classics.
That last one sounds tough. What modern classic do I have to read?
Dick and Jane at the Seashore.
Well, that's more like it.
I'm afraid so.
Well, how are you making out, Flash?
Just dandy fool, Mr. Scout.
You know who this is?
Of course, the Scoutmaster.
No, this is our coach, Rocky Canute. Put it there, pal.
Oh, thanks a mil. It was getting mighty heavy.
Maybe you better suit up, Moose.
In a few moments, Bullwinkle was attired in his very own football uniform.
Bullwinkle, you're barefoot.
Yeah, I like to feel my toes grip the earth. Besides, they didn't have any size 22s.
Well, let's see you throw one, Moose.
Throw a game already? I haven't even started practicing yet.
Not a game, a pass. Let's see you throw a forward pass.
Okay. How's this?
And Bullwinkle faded back, cocked his arm, and fired a forward pass that traveled... a miserable 10 feet and fell to the ground.
How's that, Coach? Coach? Gee, where'd he go?
Over in a dead faint, that's where.
Well, is this the end of Bullwinkle's sports career? Be sure to see our next episode, The Hidden Ball Play, or Goal is Where You Find It.
Here on The Bullwinkle Show, we believe in history. Because history means progress. And if it wasn't for progress, where would we be today? On radio, that's where. So now, to take a jack for a boob's eye view of history, here's that canine quiz kid, that low-slung doggy with the high IQ, Mr. Peabody.
Our story opens today high atop New York City, in the luxurious penthouse of perhaps the most famous soldier of fortune the world has ever known. Me. How do you do? Excuse the position, just practicing my yoga. Well, now that you're here, we may as well get to know each other. My name is Peabody. I suppose you know yours. I guess you're wondering about this contraption. It belongs to Sherman. He's my boy. Here, Sherman. Here, boy. Shake hands. Say hello.
Hello.
Smart as a whip, isn't he? Now about this amusing little gadget. The story really starts with me. Naturally. As a youth, I was just an average genius. The puppy prodigy, they called me. Got my degree at Harvard when I was 3. Wagner cum laude, of course. Then a brief period in the Foreign Service. I speak 8 languages fluently. All at once, that is, including English. Then a few research projects for the government. And I dabbled in the stock market, where I was known as the Wolf of Wall Street. But somehow I felt that something was missing in my life. So I made up my mind to get a boy. I looked high and low, but couldn't find one that met my high standards. Then one day, while watching some boys at their innocent play, I spotted Sherman. My heart went out to him. I'm always pulling for the underboy. I dismissed the others, and Sherman followed me home. He wasn't at all what I was looking for. Oh, he looked at me with those big brown eyes. But I was firm. I took him home. This is where you live?
Yep, that's been home sweet home all my life.
Where have you been, you little brat?
Just visiting.
Get in here.
One moment, sir.
And what do you want, mutt?
The name, sir, is Peabody. And I intend to adopt this boy. Naturally, the newspapers made a big thing of it.
Extra! Extra!
I had to submit references. So I got some old friends to write letters. Then, of course, I was investigated thoroughly. My background was unimpeachable. Still...
But he's not a fit person to bring up a boy. In fact, he's not even a person at all.
Your Honor, I consider that an excellent recommendation. And I finally got Sherman.
This court can see no reason why. If a boy can have a dog can't have a boy.
Daddy!
Sherman, let's get one thing clear. I will never submit to being addressed by that ridiculous name. You will call me Mr. Peabody. Or when speaking informally, simply Peabody.
Yes, Mr. Peabody.
So, that was that. But I soon found it's next to impossible to raise a boy in an apartment. Guppies, yes, but a boy, no. They need running room. So I built this for Sherman's birthday. Happy birthday, Sherman.
Gee, thanks, Mr. Peabody. Well, what is it?
Well, actually, it's a time machine. I call it a Wayback. We just set it, turn it on, open the door, and there we are. Or were, really.
Pluribus delenda est, interes partes argentum sum.
What'd he say? What'd he say?
Well, that's simple. He said, oh, never mind. I'll fix it.
So, friends, for a goodbye in a new or used chariot, it's Publius Maximus the Grinning Gaul.
It sounded better in Latin. Can we go somewhere else?
Of course.
With this key, friend.
Mr. Franklin, the lightning!
I intend to demonstrate the principle illustrated by the storage properties of the Leyden jar.
B.F., the lightning is...
Gee, we couldn't get a word in edgewise.
I know. A few more adjustments, and behold, not a time machine, but a should-have-been machine. Observe.
With this key, friend...
Mr. Franklin, your kite is going to be struck by lightning.
Oh, really?
It's nice to be a part of history. But all in all, it's just the thing for a boy in an apartment. Eh, Sherman? Well, I thought it was. Of course, he's only a boy, and...
Mr. Peabody, that's the nicest present anybody ever had.
Yes, of course, Sherman. No doubt about it. Every dog should have a boy.
We would record 5 shows in one night. By shows, I mean segments. Bullwinkle was about 3.5 minutes. So we would do 5 of those. Jay would perhaps rent the studio for 1.5 hours, which gave us 1/2 hour to laugh. In the very beginning.
Well, Bullwinkle's career as a football player had quite a setback last time when Coach Canute said...
Well, Moose, do you think you can pass?
I don't know. I'll study hard.
No, I mean a forward pass.
Oh, that. Sure. How's this?
And Bullwinkle lofted a forward pass that didn't travel more than 10 feet.
That's a forward pass.
It went forward, didn't it?
Turn in your suit, Moose.
No, wait. I think I know what's wrong, Coach. Let me center the ball.
Okay, 1, 2, 3, hut!
Now, Bullwinkle, alley!
Oop. Well, it was the alley-oop that did it. The football zoomed into the air, down the field, over the goalpost, out of the stadium, and across the campus toward the administration building!
Now, Chancellor, this here stadium will cost you only $7 million, and we can start building on...
A lot of money, Mr. Herdlicker. I don't think we... What's that?
It's a football.
How did it get here?
Offhand, I'd say it was thrown here by your new fullback.
Well, don't just stand there, Herdlicker. Build something.
And immediately, work started on a brand new stadium for What's the Matter You? While on the practice field, Bullwinkle and Rocky worked out with the rest of the team.
Owie!
Oof! Oh, I got it.
Gee, not so hard, Bullwinkle. That's the third pass receiver we've lost today.
We don't lose him, Rock. They pick him up in the next county.
But passing wasn't Bullwinkle's only football talent. When he put his head down and charged, he could take out one whole side of the opposing line.
That's what I like, a player who uses his head.
It's also good for hanging hats on.
Came time for Wasamatayu's first game with the Watchmakers Technical Institute.
Or as it is known, tick-tock tick.
It wasn't a game. It was a slaughter.
Billy!
Oof!
A minute before the end of the game, with Wasamatayu leading 66-0, Coach Canute took Bullwinkle out. Immediately, things were different. In the next 60 seconds, Tick-Tock-Tick scored 60 points. But then the final gun sounded. Well, a big upset like that didn't go unnoticed.
Whoa! Look what the newspapers say about the game, Rock.
I don't see anything.
Look down here. Wasamata 66, Tick-Tock 60.
The type's too small for me to read.
But as the season progressed, the headlines got bigger and bigger.
What's the matter, you? 90. Barely normal. 0.
What's the matter, 89? Purdy Polly. 0.
What's the matter, 150? DeCoin's Grammar School, 0?
A little mix-up in the schedule there.
What's the matter was the only team in the nation which was undefeated and untied.
Not untied, we're just a little loose is all.
But on television, every silver lining has a dark cloud, and our show is no different. For in a downtown bat cave in a large city, some professional gamblers were posting betting odds on next week's game.
Oh, boy. You see the odds on what's the matter, you? 200-1.
Incredible.
Well, Natasha, this is it. This is the time for me to turn over a new leaf.
What?
You know how I am, Honeybun. Always destroying things, wrecking them, smashing them up.
Yes.
Well, now I'm going to do just the opposite of breaking things.
You mean?
Yes. I'm going to fix a game.
He's just the fixer to do it, too. Oh, don't fail to see Wager at Dawn or Early to Bet.
Look, Bullwinkle, a message in a bow.
Fan mail from some flounder?
No, this is what I really call a message.
The Toyota 4x4, number one in Northern California.
Wrap it up, I'll take it.
The Toyota 4x2, starting at around $6,600.
Wrap it up.
The incredible Toyota 4Runner.
I'll take it.
Your Toyota dealers have special factory incentives to sell a million vehicles by January 5th. And time is running out. So wrap up the right deal right now.
Wrap them up. We'll take them.
Who could ask for anything more?
In the desert, you can see 2,000 species of plant life, 500 species of animal life, and an occasional birdie.
When you'd like to stay in one place without staying in one place, head for the Delta.
I haven't seen Gary lately.
He went on vacation to the Caribbean.
Why?
Call for a free pocket guide and discover the Californias.
Intermission, the show that asks, how much do you really know about the silver screen? This intermission brought to you by Efferdent. In this 1919 silent classic, an evil doctor hypnotized his victim to carry out his schemes. What's the name of this film? On our 10-point scale, this question has a difficulty rating of 9.
My dentures look great.
You've just had your dentures professionally cleaned.
But how can I keep them looking this way?
With this.
Efferdent?
Professional strength Efferdent. With a powerful blue action formula that removes stains, kills germs, and cleans away plaque, leaves dentures clean even in between.
Now I get a professional-looking clean every day.
Efferdent, for a professional-looking clean even in between. Efferdent is accepted by the American Dental Association.
Surrealistic sets created a foreboding mood in the German impressionistic film The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari.
You're watching Bullwinkle's New Year's special on KTVU's 8 o'clock movie special.
If you're a California taxpayer, can you really afford not to think about tax-free investing? Well, the Fidelity California Tax-Free Fund earns high current yields tax-free, double tax-free, free from federal and California personal income taxes. So you keep all the interest income you earn. And since Fidelity knows that investors' goals vary, California Tax-Free also offers you a choice. There's the money market portfolio for stability of principal and convenience. And there's the high-yield portfolio for higher tax-free yields. Either way, the income is double tax-free, and you pay no commission. Plus, you'll have free check writing and exchange privileges with over 30 other Fidelity funds. So ask about the California Tax-Free Fund. Call Fidelity toll-free 24 hours a day at 1-800-237-4900. That's 1-800-237-4900. If you're a California taxpayer, it could make a world of difference.
I'm heading up a convoy of Chevy S10s. Mind if I pay for the trucks behind me?
No problem. Say, these Chevy S10s are real rugged looking. Come with V6 power, don't they?
You bet. This year, Chevy dealers are going to have more than ever before.
Say, how many S10s are you delivering to the Chevy dealers?
Oh, about 6-7 miles worth.
3,500 S10s are on hand now. Test drive one at your local Chevy dealer.
You'll find it here at Tri-City. We're the world's largest sporting goods store, and we're having the world's largest after Christmas blowout sale. We want out of all our Christmas merchandise. If Santa didn't bring it, come to Fremont and get it for less. You'll think we've gone crazy. You'll think we've gone mad. How can Tri-City blow out merchandise at such low prices? Simple, when you're the world's largest, you do what you want. Step aside, Macy's and Nordstrom's. You're in Tri-City territory. Adult toys at after Christmas prices like never before. But hurry before it's all gone. The world's largest after Christmas sporting goods sale. Happening now, only at Tri-City in Fremont.
Pokey smoke, Bullwinkle, it's showtime.
Well, the latest sensation of the sports pages these days is Wassamata U, and its forward-passing phenom, Bullwinkle Moose.
Look, Natasha, 200 to 1.
Some score, darling.
Score nothing. Those are the betting odds on Wassamata U.
Boris, why you're smiling that sneaky little smile?
I know Moose can throw passes. I wonder if he could throw a whole game.
Meanwhile, it wasn't all cleats and shoulder pads for our heroes. Eager to make good grades, they really had to burn the midnight oil.
How come we're burning the midnight oil, Rock?
They turn off the electricity at 10 o'clock.
Oh, Nick 1, Pearl 2, Nick 2, Pearl 1, Nick 1, Pearl 2.
What are you doing, Bullwinkle?
Studying for a test.
In what?
My toughest class, advanced crocheting. Nick 1, Nick 2, Pearl 1, Pearl 2.
Yeah, but why so fast?
I'm cramming.
Not that life at Wassamata U was all work and no play. There were lots of typical collegiate good fellowship and hygiene.
Howdy, fellers. How about seeing how many of us can file into a phone booth?
I don't think we've met, old boy.
I know, but how about some typical collegiate good fellowship and hijinks? We could all go over to my place and swallow goldfish.
But...
there's enough for everybody. I just got my allowance.
You must be insane. Come on, chaps. We're all going over to picket Norman Mailer at the student union.
Gee, Bullwinkle.
What am I going to do with 300 goldfish?
Well, why don't
you... But although Bullwinkle didn't know it, he had an even more serious problem.
Well, Natasha, it's great to be back on the campus.
Back? Boris, you went to college? Penn State?
No, State Penn.
But how are we going to convince Moose he should lose a football game?
We got secret weapon, honeybun.
Oh, I love secrets. Let's see.
Here is secret weapon.
Boris, is me.
And thus it was that next day when Bullwinkle and Rocky left the practice field, they were confronted by a weeping figure.
Boo-hoo-hoo. Hold it, Bullwinkle. That sounds like a lady in distress.
So?
Gee, didn't you ever read the Hero's Handbook?
I can never get past the picture of General MacArthur on the cover.
Well, Chapter 2 says we should always help ladies in distress.
Hi there, lady. Are you in distress?
Distress, that dress, who cares? I'm distraught.
Do we help ladies in distraught?
What's the trouble?
It's about next Saturday's game.
With Hard Knocks College. Don't worry, we'll mobilize them.
That's just it. My little brother is on that team.
Your brother?
Crazy Legs Kalbfuss. And if Hard Knocks doesn't win Saturday, they'll throw him off the team.
Gee.
They'll take away his sweater.
And it's turning cool, too.
They won't even let him watch American Bandstand.
Is there no pity anywhere?
So... your great, big, wonderful Moose.
That's me, all right.
Maybe you could see to it that Hard Knocks wins next Saturday.
Why not?
Bullwinkle, you can't do that.
I'm supposed to help ladies in distress.
But Chapter 3 says you never throw a game.
Well, you read your chapter, I'll read mine. What was that you called me, Missy?
A great, big, wonderful schnook.
Sounds different this time.
Well, has Bullwinkle fallen prey to Boris and Natasha's vile scheme so quickly? Be with us next time for Standing Room Only, or Bullwinkle Sells Out.
When we first recorded the show, we never really realized that it would have the impact on society. Actually, the maturation of young people into adults. We never realized that it would be the cult that it is. Now they're understanding the brilliance of the writing and the puns and the jokes that they didn't get before. And I think that's why the kids who are now grown up are really realizing what a fantastic satirical show that it was.
Time again for Dudley Do-Right of the Mounties. The only redcoat who never gets his man. Never gets the girl either. You'll be happy to know that this part of the Bullwinkle Show has made the greatest mark on Canada since the chickenpox epidemic of 1903.
Of the 19th century, Canada was overrun with Canadians and smugglers. The best Canadian, but the worst smuggler was Snidely Whiplash. Whiplash and his band of smugglers were traveling through Canada as a band of musicians. Unfortunately, his music was very bad.
Of course it's bad. Not only are my boys tone deaf, but their instruments are filled with stolen furs.
Yes, that was how the arch criminal smuggled furs out of Canada. But like all lawbreakers, he had yet to reckon with the mounted police. You are looking at the pride of that noble force, our hero, Dudley Do-Right. And this is Dudley Do-Right's horse. The apple of Dudley's eye was the beautiful yet unpredictable Nell Fenwick. Dudley loved Nell. Unfortunately, she loved his horse.
But Nell, why won't you marry me?
Because you are too good, Dudley.
For you, Nell, I would rotten up.
The Mountie Post was under the command of Inspector Fenwick, Nell's father.
Send Constable Do-Right in here and tell him to hurry.
You sent for me, sir?
Yes, I did, Do-Right. Snidely Whiplash is attempting to smuggle furs over the border into the United States. I shall need an undercover man to join him and expose his evil plan.
Let's send Nell, sir.
My daughter? No, Do-Right. We have to send a mounted.
Then you go, sir.
I have to watch the store. You're the man, Do-Right.
But, Inspector, my reputation, Whiplash would never let me join him.
Yes, your record is spotless. We shall have to dirty it somewhat. Here's my plan. You shall commit a disgraceful act, get thrown out of the service, and become a bad guy.
Thus it was that 1 hour later, Constable Dudley Do-Right, the man who could do no wrong, set fire to the Alberta Hotel.
Do-Right, are you responsible for this holocaust?
Why, yes, I am.
Well, congratulations, my boy. This hotel was condemned last year, and we've been wondering how to tear it down. You'll be decorated for this.
Do-Right, you idiot. Don't do right, do wrong.
The dam! Somebody blew up the dam!
Would you mind holding this plunger until the police get here and arrest me?
Constable Do-Right has already admitted that it was he who dynamited the dam. Yes, in one brilliant stroke, the problem of irrigating our valley has been solved.
Do-Right, have you ever been assassinated?
But, Inspector, I have been trying.
Well, then don't try.
And that did the trick. At mess that evening, Dudley ate his peas with a knife, something no Mountie would ever do, and consequently was drummed out of the service with a dishonorable discharge.
Do-Right, you're a disgrace to your underwear. Good work, my boy. Now join up with Snidely Whiplash.
Farewell, Nell. Perhaps we'll meet again.
But, Dudley, why must your horse go with you? After all, you ate the peas.
Yes, but with his knife. Adios, Nell.
1 week later, in a border town ballroom...
So you're a musician, eh?
Yes.
Can you read music?
No.
You're hired.
Dudley brought out an alpine horn and proceeded to captivate the audience. But during the 33rd chorus of Wabash Cannonball, the tuba player started spraying furs all over the bandstand.
Whiplash, the jig is up. You are under arrest. Drop that tuba.
And the tuba player did, and Dudley.
In exactly 5 minutes, Do-Right, my men, the furs, and I will be safely across the border. You too will be crossing the border at a much higher altitude.
4 minutes and 59 seconds later, Snidely Whiplash and his men were about to set foot across the border when...
Halt! You are under arrest!
Egad, Do-Right, how did you escape?
I didn't, Whiplash. There are two of us. The one you left tied up back there in the shack was my horse, in a Dudley suit. And here he comes now! Good work, horse.
Good work, Do-Right. You not only saved the furs and captured the smugglers, but you got their ringleader, Snidely Whiplash.
Oh, no, you didn't.
Snidely, how did you escape?
There are two of us!
Have you got your horse's knife on you, Do-Right?
Yes, sir.
Then go eat peas. You've got to do it all over again.
Let's send Nell, sir.
We can't. She's not a mountain.
Then you go.
Now, everybody raise their right hands and repeat after me.
I solemnly swear to be honest, loyal, brave, clean, and trustworthy.
Just a minute, buddy.
Something wrong?
Wrong? Who, boy? What is this honest, brave, and loyal stuff?
It's the new fan club oath.
Maybe later on it mentions sly, nasty, and vile?
Nope. Just honest, brave, clean, loyal, and trustworthy.
What kind oath is that? You expect me to sell out, give up my way of life? I got low standards, you know. Come, Natasha, we start our own outfit. The Boris Badenov Fan Club. Well, what do you think of the new clubhouse?
It's real eyesore, Boris.
You really think so? You're not just saying that to make me feel good?
Oh, I wouldn't kid you, darling. With little work, it could be blight our whole community.
Think big, Natasha. We'll have Boris Badenov Fan Club's blemishing whole country. New chapters festering up everywhere.
How do we do this, Boris?
How else? Advertise on television. Feeling grouchy, irritable, nasty? Then Boris's Fan Club needs you. Modern day clean living got you down? Want to strike a blow for foul play? Then join Boris Badenov Beast Corps.
This was a paid fanatical announcement.
Double your pleasure, double your fun. Join Boris's Fan Club and learn hit and run.
Look, Natasha, he's working already. Look at those members.
Yes, Boris, but can they be trusted?
Trusted? Natasha, what a thing to say. Of course they can't be trusted. They're our kind of people.
People knew that I had done Natasha, and they didn't realize that I did Rocky and Natasha and Little Nell and all the fairy godmothers and all the witches, you know, with the warts on their nose and all the little princesses, because they all had such a distinctive style that none of them sounded like Rocky or Natasha. And I guess I was very fortunate in that respect in being so versatile, and I think that's why Jay Ward hired me.
Well, well, the Wasamata U football team continues to roll like a juggernaut over its opponents, sparked by the flashy passing combination of Rocky Squirrel and Bull McLemoose.
Billy!
But Boris Badenov, against all common sense, is betting heavily against Wasamata.
Put all this on Hard Knocks College next Saturday.
On Hard Knocks? Fellas, take off your hats. It ain't often we see such touching childlike faith. Mister, you got our sympathy.
Put your hats back on. I also got a fiendish plan.
And what a plan it was. Natasha, disguised as a forlorn co-ed named Miriam Kalfus, convinced Bullwinkle that her brother was on the Hard Knocks Football 11.
And if they don't win, he'll be thrown off the team.
Never fear, Miriam dear.
Oh, poetry.
Isn't it, though? And what's more, curfew shall not ring tonight.
What's that mean?
I don't know, but it sure sounds impressive.
Bullwinkle, I don't think she even has a brother.
Yeah, but she sure has long eyelashes.
I think she's trying to trick you.
Rock, I'm surprised.
If she does have a football player for a brother, where is he? Where is this Crazy Legs Calbfuss?
You called?
You Crazy Legs Calbfuss.
Just look. Crazy legs, all right.
Well, that did it. The following Saturday, Bullwinkle just wasn't playing his usual game. At the end of three quarters, the score was still nothing to nothing.
Bullwinkle, you fumbled!
I bet those eyelashes are 2 inches long.
As a matter of fact, the only reason Hard Knocks hadn't scored was that they were almost as bad a team as Wasamata U.
2-7 hike.
Bullwinkle, you missed him!
Go on, Wizard! You're in the clear!
And he was too, but unfortunately, in donning his uniform, Wizard Black had inadvertently tied together the laces of his right and left shoes. As a result...
Boy, that's a lucky break.
Eyelashes must be 3 inches long.
Hey, you know who we haven't seen on the field yet?
Among others, Prince Suvanafuma.
No, Crazy Legs Calbfuss.
Probably saving him for the last quarter.
This is the last quarter.
Maybe they're 4 inches long.
What are?
Miriam's eyelashes. See?
Where?
There in the end zone behind us.
Sure enough, Miriam Calbfuss.
Or as we know her, Natasha Fatah.
Was in the stands cheering for Hard Knocks.
Kill the moose! And look who's beside her.
Crazy Legs. It was a trick.
Signals. 1, 2, 3.
Oh, what a dirty guy. I'll get you, Crazy Legs.
Bullwinkle, no. You're running the wrong way.
Nobody can make a monkey's uncle out of Bullwinkle, Jay.
Oh, boy.
You know, Booby, I don't like the look in his eye.
I told you Moose had no sense of humor.
Quick as a flash, Burris slipped out of his seat and disappeared into the crowd.
Where'd he go?
Bullwinkle, look out!
Yes, by now, the mighty Moose stood at the 1 foot line, just 12 inches away from scoring the winning goal for his opponents. The Hard Knocks players struggled closer.
see these football fields alone.
Horace was still ducking through the crowd, and where? Clear at the other end of the field, the Hard Knocks players leaped on Bullwinkle to drive him over the goal. And at that moment, the referee raised his gun to signal the end of the game.
Boy, we've had everything in this episode but the kitchen sink.
What do you think this is?
Well, is Wasamata U doomed to its first defeat? We'll find out in our next excitement-riddled episode, Bullwinkle Scores Again, or Fool's Goal.
Today's lesson is mighty important, remember?
Bullwinkle is a...
Not that lesson. This lesson.
It's at your Nissan dealers now, the 87 Nissan Fever, on all models, including the 87 Nissan King Cab 4x4 with more horsepower than any truck in its class, or the Nissan Standard Bed with more head and leg room than Toyota. And right now, get 3.9% financing or up to $800 cash back. It's 87 Nissan Fever.
Music, gorgeous outfit. He'll take me in his arms and...
Yuck! Looks great, but it feels so stiff and staticky. I can't wear this.
You need improved Bold 3. Better cleaning, a new softener, a static fighter like a dryer sheet has, all in one.
Beautiful clean. It feels so soft. Even controls the cling.
For clothes that feel as good as they look, get improved Bold 3.
Happy New Year, you wild party animal. Let's get going.
Get the new year going by saving at Bruner's New Year's Day sale.
Come on, honey, the whole store's on sale.
Thursday, for one day only. Store-wide savings of 10 to 50%. And pay nothing till April.
Don't you want that new recliner to watch all the games?
Bruner's New Year's Day sale. 14 hours only, 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. Pay nothing till April.
Just think, sweetheart, we'll have the place all set up for tonight's party.
Ford fever is hot, and the world's hottest-selling car is moving fast. The new Ford Escort GT has arrived with 3.9% financing. It won't last long. This offer will be gone January 4th.
You're watching Bullwinkle's New Year's special on KTVU's 8 o'clock movie special.
Hello, I'm McDonald Cherry. As almost everyone does, I sometimes suffer from arthritic-like aches and pains brought on by tension and overwork. But I've discovered a wonderful solution to this type of suffering, which I'd like to share with you. It's this fantastic Niagara Rolisage Power Recliner with heat and patented cyclomassage therapy units. If you'll call the number on your screen right now, I'll mail to you all of the details on this amazing tension and pain-relieving chair. I'll also include a free TV discount coupon, which will save you money. The Niagara chair works. The Rolisage unit gently moves up and down your aching muscles from your neck to the base of your spine while soothing cyclomassage therapy and heat are applied. Plus, heat and cyclomassage therapy and the leg rest help to restore those painful calves and feet. Relief from muscular aches, pains, everyday tension and fatigue is only a phone call away. So call now for your free, no-obligation Niagara information kit and money-saving TV discount coupon.
As McDonald Carey likes to say, Niagara has a better way, so call right now.
If you're up against the old boy network, keep in mind that the secret of business success isn't who you know, it's what you know. The Wall Street Journal gives you all the connections you need to the boardrooms, the markets, the trends, the news. The information that can help you make intelligent business decisions. In fact, if you read the journal, you'll find that to achieve success, you don't have to be old, and you don't even have to be a boy.
Dodge Center in Redwood City has done it again, just in time for the smart buyer to save hundreds, even thousands of dollars.
Well, there's factory financing of 3.9% on 31 models. $500 rebate or cash direct from the factory that you can use as down payment or spend any way you please. And special factory discounts up to $1,200 on popular equipment packages.
And if you buy before December 31st, you can deduct the sales tax from your income tax.
That's Dodge Center, 640 Veterans Boulevard, Redwood City.
From the Bayshore, take the Whipple Avenue exit.
I felt very meek being there, getting paid to do a job to witness disaster.
Anytime anything comes up about it, it just all, you know, it all comes flooding back. I mean, it had a very powerful impact on the story meant so much to me just because it...
KTVU reporters go behind events to reveal their inner feelings while covering the year's most powerful stories. Looking Back 86, a special report tonight on the 10 o'clock news.
Happy New Year to everyone, except Moose and Squirrel.
Well, in our last episode, Bullwinkle was just about to make football history. It wasn't matter you.
He's heading for the wrong goal.
Right, for in the stands, Bullwinkle had spotted Crazy Legs Cobfuss.
Doggone Crazy Legs. Here I'd be taking it easy so he wouldn't get thrown off the team. Now I find out he's not even on it.
And Bullwinkle stopped just 1 foot short of the wrong goal line with a horde of tacklers coming after him. But just then...
Bye-bye, bird brain.
Yes, Boris popped into sight, clear at the other end of the stadium.
Oh, Baz said.
Things had happened fast and furious.
I'm fast and he's furious.
So angry was Bullwinkle that he looked around for something to throw at the fleeting Boris. There was only one thing handy, the football. He hurled it just as he was hit by a cloud of tacklers. The ball zoomed over the heads of the astonished players. It was clearly headed right out of the stadium. But just as it reached the end zone, a furry streak intercepted it.
It's a touchdown! We win! Yay!
Ow!
Is that the end, Boris?
It's not my elbow, honey bun.
Let that be a lesson to you, Bullwinkle. Always play your best game, no matter what the provocation.
Yeah, what the provocation I always do.
As a result of Bullwinkle's performance, Wasamata became the top-ranked team in the country. Their new stadium was packed every weekend with thousands of fans. Wasamata was making money hand over fist over hand. Gentlemen, Bullwinkle Moose is the greatest football attraction since Blue Grange.
Isn't that Red Grange, Chancellor?
Let's not be controversial, Harkabee. Wasamata is in the black for the first time in history.
At last we can afford to get some new teaching equipment.
Yes, my world map is so old it still shows the Earth is flat.
But nobody believes that.
Our current event books say that McKinley is still president.
And lots of people believe that.
You mean he isn't?
But now we can afford better teaching tools.
Gentlemen, you must be mad.
No new equipment?
Of course. New athletic equipment. We can't afford to offend Coach Canute. And so in rapid succession, Wasamata built an indoor baseball diamond, a 97-room home for Coach Canute, and a pink marble field house shaped like the Taj Mahal.
It's lovely by moonlight.
How about another test tube for the physics lab?
We gotta draw the line somewhere. Besides, it's time to meet the latest addition to our faculty, the world's greatest mathematical genius, Dr. Isosceles Digit.
Dr. Digit, are you here to start a new math department?
Are you kidding, Jack? I'm here to figure out new football plays.
And meanwhile, what are those two heels without soles, Boris and Natasha?
Yes, what of us, darling?
Natasha, there's only one way to fix the game and beat that idiot Moose.
And that is?
We got to get our own football team.
And within a few days, Boris had assembled the meanest, toughest gang of rascals and rogues in the state, the Mud City Manglers.
Look at them, Natasha.
Must I, darling? I just had lunch.
And wait till you meet the coach.
Darling, who could be mean and cruel enough to coach this mob of killers?
Who else?
You don't mean.
All right, team, a little pepper. Last man out of the huddle is the first man dead.
Boris, his fearless leader.
Yeah, he's doing a guest shot in this sequence.
A guest shot?
There goes a guest now.
Well, what a team this is for our heroes to face. Be sure to see our next episode, Rogues Gallery, or Hold That Lineup.
Once upon a time, there was a Pied Piper. He was called a Pied Piper for two very good reasons. One, he smoked a pipe, and two, by some strange method known only to him, he was able to blow pies out of it. Hence the name, Pied Piper. One day, as he was sitting beside the road, whiling away the hours, blowing banana cream pies, a merchant from the city happened along.
Say, that's very interesting, what you're doing there.
The Pied Piper just grinned at the merchant and started blowing blackberry pies.
That's mighty, mighty clever. Have you ever thought of going into the pie business, my boy?
The Piper didn't answer. He merely switched to mince pies.
With this kid's talent, I have the feeling that I could make a fortune.
So saying, the merchant took the piper by the hand and led him to the city, leaving a trail of pumpkin, apple, and other assorted pies behind. Now, offhand, one would think that this was the start of a beautiful success story, but such was hardly the case. For the merchant opened a little pie shop, and for his very first customer, a near-sighted little fellow walked in and said,
Unpack a latakia, please.
Latakia? What's that?
It's tobacco.
But we don't sell tobacco here. We sell pies.
And to illustrate, the merchant had the Pied Piper pipe up a rhubarb pie. Not wishing to smoke a rhubarb pie, the customer departed. This conversation seemed to have a strange effect on the piper. He stood on his head for 24 hours and refused to eat. 1 week later, another customer entered the store.
I would like a peach pie, please.
Joyfully, the merchant turned to the piper and instructed him to bake. But unfortunately, instead of a pie, a leaf of tobacco came out of the pipe.
What's the matter with you? You were supposed to pipe up a peach pie, not a tobacco leaf.
Perhaps I'd best be going.
You stay here. I'll try again.
The piper smiled and puffed away, and out came a pie. But it was a pie filled with tobacco leaves.
Who ever heard of a tobacco pie?
Well, it's the latest thing, sir. You can eat dessert and smoke at the same time.
But the customer wanted no part of such a silly thing as that and departed with haste. At that moment, the king, who was quite a gourmet and known for his love of rare, strange foods, was passing the shop and...
My, what is that I smell? Why, it's this pie. What kind is it?
A tobacco leaf.
Tobacco leaf pie? Latakia, isn't it?
Must be.
I am pleased. I hereby dub thee my royal bakers. Tomorrow you will move into the castle and each day bake a tobacco leaf pie for me.
Bright and early the next morning, they arrived at the castle and before long were called upon to bake their first pie.
I have just finished my breakfast, and now to top it off, I should like my tobacco leaf pie.
In a jiffy, the Pied Piper piped up a tobacco leaf pie.
Say, that smells like genuine Latakia again.
Oh, yes, sire. Bite?
By all means.
The king promptly took a huge bite, rolled it around in his mouth, swallowed it, and with a poof, disappeared into thin air.
Why, his highness has disappeared.
Oh, thank goodness. I was afraid he was going to get sick.
Now the aroma of the tobacco leaf pie proved to be most irresistible, and the queen insisted upon a taste.
But, your grace, the king just took one bite and disappeared. You...
Oh, that's... Silly! How could one bite of this delicious-smelling pie make one?
Good heavens! Now look what you and your tobacco leaf pies have done. We're responsible for the disappearance of the king and queen.
They decided that it would be best to flee before what they had done could be discovered. And so they headed back to the bakery, and a most important decision was made by the merchant.
Now look, no more of those tobacco leaf pies. You see...
This had a rather strange effect on the Pied Piper, for he proceeded to pipe up tobacco leaf pies by the hundreds. Within the hour, the aroma of these pies had crept into every corner of the kingdom.
How wonderful!
Latakia! Latakia!
Thousands of people stormed the bakery, and the tobacco leaf pies by the score disappeared, and so did the people, until at last all that remained was the merchant, the piper, and one tobacco leaf pie.
I get it now. This has all been a mad scheme of yours to rid the kingdom of people. And I'm the only people left. Well, I'm not afraid to go. You hear? I'm not afraid. Give me that pie. Say, this is good.
The piper couldn't believe his eyes. The merchant actually took a bite of the pie and didn't disappear. Fearing that something had gone wrong with his recipe, the piper took a bite of the pie himself and promptly disappeared. Well, yes, the recipe was all there.
Which is more than could be said for the piper. Yuck, yuck.
But I don't understand. Everybody in the kingdom disappeared when they took a bite of that strange pie. Why didn't you?
Are you kidding? I don't believe in all those fairy tale hocus pocuses. Witches, evil spells, sleeping beauties, magic pies. Bah! It's all a lot of...
And now, here's that man with helpful hints for everyone in the land. Mr. Know-It-All.
Hello there, hinterlanders everywhere. Today we take up the problem of how to become a successful member of the U.S. Peace Corps. When you are sent into primitive country to help your fellow man, the first important thing is to find a fellow man. Then show them that your country has a new approach. The people back home really care. Offer them beads and trinkets. Primitive peoples like this appreciate that kind of thing. If, However you find their state of industrial or scientific development farther along than you had supposed, the Peace Corps workers should offer assistance by showing the foreign friend how to repair or improve whatever devices they have. Kindly, brother, I have fixed your machine, so it is quieter now. Courtesy, U.S. Peace Corps! The next most important thing is to work along with them. That nothing too difficult for them is too difficult for you. And there you have it! The end product inspired by cooperation, friendship, and brotherhood.
Gosh, Mr. Know-It-All, it looks to me like you've just inspired this friendly friend from another land to build a rocket ship.
Yeah, happens every time.
Is it for defense?
No.
Space travel?
No.
Then what?
It's their way of getting me out of the country faster.
Well, it was a big day for What's the Matter You when the chancellor said...
Many colleges are de-emphasizing football. What's the Matter will re-emphasize it.
One of the college's first acts was to sign up the Frostbite Falls Flash Bullwinkle Moose, who, aided by Rocky the Flying Squirrel, proceeded to decimate the opposition.
No, no, we just beat the other team.
That's what the man said.
Well, why don't he say what he says?
But it looked like breakers ahead for What's the Matter, for in a carefully guided hideout, Boris Badenov's Mud City Manglers were hard at work. They were a dreadful band of thugs and killers, coached by our old nemesis, fearless leader, and even he had to use a whip and a chair.
All right, we'll try number 17.
One, two, three.
Uh-oh. Strangler fumbled the ball again.
Yeah, I bet the coach gives him a light reprimand.
Oh, I bet he gives him a severe reprimand. You were right. It was just a light reprimand.
Yes, with a team of hired goons and criminals, Fearless Leader was at his best or worst.
I want all of you men to read this sign I'm posting in the locker room.
Play carefully. The life you save may be your own.
But of course, being villains had certain advantages, too.
Achtung! Tackle practice. I want you to tackle that dummy as if it were a What's the Matter You runner. Go! Terrible. Awful.
Fearless leader, all the sand is running out of the tackling dummy.
All right, which one of you stabbed the tackling dummy in the back?
It was me.
You stabbed a defenseless dummy in the back?
Yeah, what of it?
Well, congratulations, my boy. You're my kind of folks. From now on, you're captain of the team.
That's the way to talk, coach.
When I want your approval, I'll ask for it.
Yes, fearless leader.
All right, I'm asking.
Hooray!
Meanwhile, in the chancellor's office at What's the Matter You...
Hey, you guys.
Yes, Coach Canute?
I got a letter here from a team I never heard of, challenging us to a game.
What's the team?
The Mud City Manglers.
Mud City? Oh, no.
Challenge game?
No.
They'll pay us $1,000.
It's a deal.
And so in a short while, the wire services were buzzing with the news...
Mud City? Never heard of them.
Here's the picture of the team.
How do they look?
They sure got funny-looking helmets on.
Helmets? Nothing. That's hair. Bullwinkle, those are girls.
Yes, to drive the odds even higher, the Wily Boris had dressed his entire team in curly wigs and midi blouses.
Bullwinkle, this is terrible.
It is?
What kind of game can you play with girls?
Boy, this really is a children's show, isn't it? Parcheesi, of course.
The photograph caused a sensation.
Girls challenge nation's number one team.
Debutants to tackle juggernaut.
Little did the press of the nation know that the Mud City Manglers were a vicious gang of thieves, blackguards, and unspeakable Turks.
All right, girls, and I use the term loosely, time to check your equipment. Shoulder pads?
Check.
Spike shoes?
Check.
Poison for spikes?
Check.
Switchblade knives?
Check.
Brass knuckles?
Check.
Hand grenades?
Check.
Then we're ready. Just remember one thing.
Yes.
I want you to behave like ladies.
Well, these are shady ladies indeed, and we'll see their fiendish plot unfold next time in Mailbags or Homely are the Brave.
Meshi Falfouf out there. Peabody here.
Meshi Falfouf, Mr. Peabody?
That's Arabic for hello, Sherman. For our destination today is the Arabian Desert, the time 1917, and the man we're going to meet, the legendary Lawrence of Arabia. We set the wayback controls and were immediately teleported back through time and space. All of a sudden, there we were, inside British Secret Service headquarters at Cairo.
Gentlemen, I have two reasons for believing that Turkey is going to declare war on us. One, they've cut off our supply of Thanksgiving turkeys.
Oh, that's terrible. Bad show.
And two, they've sent a nasty letter to Parliament.
Oh, the devil, you say. They weren't brothers.
Now, we must send someone to steal the Turkish plans. Do I have any volunteers?
For some strange reason, the room emptied.
Dash it all, every time I ask for volunteers, they chicken out. I wish they'd turkey out this time.
Begging the colonel's pardon, but you have a clerk in the outside office who can do the job. His name is Lawrence. The colonel promptly called him in.
So, you think you can work undercover for us, eh, Lawrence?
I should jolly well like to try, sir.
Capital. By the way, what do you intend wearing as a disguise?
Instead of answering, Lawrence dashed from the room and quickly returned clad in a Santa Claus suit.
I thought I'd wear this Arab costume, sir.
Perhaps we better send someone else.
Mr. Peabody and I'll go with him.
Are you any good at Secret Service work, Peabody?
Colonel, I invented Secret Service. Convinced the matter was in capable paws, the colonel bid farewell. That night, Sherman and I bought Arab outfits and went to Lawrence's hotel room.
I hope he's ready to go.
I hope he's wearing the proper disguise. But instead of being dressed like an Arab, he was dressed like a pilgrim.
How do you like it?
It's stunning, stunningly wrong. Grabbing a sheet from the bed and some mattress stuffing, we soon had him properly disguised. The next thing we did was to join a caravan heading into the desert.
Is the Turkish army out there, Mr. Peabody?
Indeed it is, and I must caution you both, don't do anything that would give us away. This caravan is undoubtedly crawling with spies.
Oh, you can count on me.
I was hoping I could, but the following morning when we paused at an oasis...
Tea time, chaps. Anyone for crumpets?
That was all it took. Before we knew it, we were bound hand and foot.
Did I say something wrong?
You are all English spies. I, the Sultan, have ways of dealing with English spies.
We were tied to stakes under the broiling desert sun. And to show you how devilish that Sultan was, he put bottles of suntan lotion just out of arm's reach.
How will we ever get out of this, Mr. Peabody?
How, Sherman? It's simple. You always have a candy bar in your pocket, don't you?
Yes.
Good. Reach in, grab it, and wipe the chocolate off on my ropes. And that's the boy. Now, if I know my camels, sure enough, the odor of chocolate attracted the nearest beast, and in no time at all, he was dining on the ropes. Before long, we were all free. Sherman, you and Lawrence wait here while I sneak into the Sultan's tent and get the secret plans. I made my way carefully past the Turkish guards and into the tent where the Sultan was resting. Inside a pouch labeled Secret Plans, I found what I was after. Unfortunately...
I say, Peabody, old chap, whilst you're looking for the secret plans, see if you can find a tea cozy.
Naturally, the Sultan awoke and immediately sounded the alarm. Quick, Lawrence, this way! We ducked out a rear exit while the guards began a frantic search. I'll go get Sherman. You saddle up a camel.
You can count on me.
Yes, I found Sherman where I had left him.
Peabody, Sherman over here.
I had instructed Lawrence to saddle a camel. Instead, he had saddled the Sultan.
Guards, come here, quick. The English dogs are here.
Before we could move, we were hopelessly surrounded. That's when I reached into Lawrence's pocket and pulled out a hand grenade. Stop! One more step and I'll blow us right off the Rocky Show.
But I say, Peabody, old thing, that's not a grenade.
Later, Lawrence, later. The threat of an explosion did the trick. 1 week later, the entire Turkish army turned itself over to the British. Now, what about that grenade, Lawrence?
I was trying to tell you that's an apple. If you had pulled the stem out and thrown the ruddy thing, nothing would have happened. Watch.
Lawrence got 60 days for destroying Secret Service headquarters. As for the Sultan and his army, they were put inside large barns containing hay.
I don't get it, Mr. Peabody. How come they're in there?
Well, apparently, Sherman, somebody likes a turkey in the straw.
Sometimes I'm recognized in public because of my voice. If I say something, people say, where have I... Like Rocky, that voice, where have I heard that voice before, you know? Also, I have a picture of Rocky on my checks. And I have my little Rocky that my niece sculpted for me. And so people say... What have you got Rocky on your checks for? And I said, well, I'm the voice of Rocky. And they said, gee, now that you're talking, we recognize your voice. It comes through. Can't help it.
Wassamata, hats off to you. To thy colors, ochre and Alice blue. We will e'er be faithful and true. Hail, what's the matter? Hail, better we should be in jail. Hey, what's the matter, you?
The stirring strains of the college fight song herald the big game between What's the Matter, You and Boris Badenov's Mud City Manglers.
But gee, Rock, the Mud City Manglers are girls.
They look awful big for girls.
I guess football doesn't appeal to the petite ones.
And on the way to the football field, Boris and Natasha dashed into an illegal betting parlor.
Okay, Manny, what's the odds on the big conflict?
World War III, 6-5 and pick 'em.
No, the What's the Matter game.
Oh, an unbeaten team playing a bunch of girls? 500-1 on What's the Matter.
I'll just take me some of that. I'll bet all this on Mud City.
And I'll bet all this.
Fearless leader, where did you get all the loot?
Bad enough, that is the entire contents of the Pottsylvania treasury.
You carry the treasury wherever you go?
You don't think I'd leave it with those crooks in my government, do you?
Who says you can't take it with you?
All right, boys, you got a bet, but you're throwing your money away.
Who says?
I hope he's wrong and you're right, Badenov.
Oh, I am.
Because there's something else I always carry around with me.
A cheery smile?
No, my own firing squad.
Oh, boy. Natasha, we really got to make sure of this one.
But, darling, we already got fiendish plans.
We can't take chances. This time our fiendish plan will have a fiendish plan.
And back in our hero's dormitory room...
Come on, Bullwinkle, it's time we left for the game.
Just a sec, Rock. I'm still studying these new plays.
Why? The only play you know is the forward pass. Besides, you're not the quarterback.
No, I'm the all-back.
Fullback.
Yeah.
Oh, if our boys only knew, for at that moment, the What's the Matter quarterback, Bob Waterbucket, was receiving a caller.
I don't wear a collar. My neck's too big.
Not a collar. A caller.
Oh.
Emergency telegram for Bob Waterbucket.
That's me.
Well, read it.
It's got long words in it.
Ooh. Oh, very well. It says your aunt in Azusi fell down and broke her crown. You should rush right out there.
But I can't. I gotta call the big game.
In that case, here's another telegram. The president has just declared the national emergency. You're drafted.
I'll get a deferment. I gotta call the big game.
Oh, boy. In that case, here's my third and last emergency telegram.
Nothing can stop me from calling that game.
It's from a professional football team. They want to hire you for... You're not going to call the game?
Sure, I'm calling it off.
As a result of Waterbucket's sudden departure, Coach Rocky Canute had a tough decision to make.
Okay, Moose, you're quarterback.
Boo!
Oh, come on, fellas. Even the Moose should be able to beat a team of schoolgirls.
But as we know, the Mud City Manglers are only disguised as girls. Actually, they're a tough bunch of thugs and plug uglies.
But, Boris, suppose the Moose remembers all the plays.
What plays? I got the only other copy of the diagrams here.
Then what was Moose studying?
The diagrams I substituted for them.
Which were?
For 3 weeks, the Moose has been studying battle plans for the Civil War.
Well, it looks as if the South may rise again. Don't miss Mine Eyes Have Seen the Gory, or Moose is in the Cold, Cold Ground.
Eeny, meeny, chili beeny, the spirits are about to speak.
Are they friendly spirits?
Friendly? Just listen.
The time, right now. The place, your Mazda dealers. The event, Goodbye 86. We're saying goodbye with goodbyes on all our 87s, 323s, 626s, even our X7s. And special factory cash incentives can save you hundreds on 87 B2000 trucks. Buy now while sales tax is still deductible. But hurry, the end is almost here. See your local Mazda dealer for a goodbye now. Don't let time run out.
Air Cal 737 Executive Class Service versus the airline that wants you to catch their smile. Only Air Cal gives you first class legroom. And breakfast complete with a morning newspaper. And a variety of superior meals. Even telephone service and premium wines by the glass are available. And Air Cal's executive class service doesn't cost one penny more. The airline that will really leave you smiling is Air Cal. We make flying easy.
You'll find it here at Tri-City. We're the world's largest sporting goods store, and we're having the world's largest after-Christmas blowout sale. We want out of all our Christmas merchandise. If Santa didn't bring it, come to Fremont and get it for less. You'll think we've gone crazy. You'll think we've gone mad. How can Tri-City blow out merchandise at such low prices? Simple, when you're the world's largest, you do what you want. Step aside, Macy's and Nordstrom's. You're in Tri-City territory. Adult toys at after-Christmas prices like never before. But hurry before it's all gone. The world's largest after-Christmas sporting goods sale. Happening now, only at Tri-City in Fremont.
This classic Mustang has been driven over 100,000 miles on a remanufactured engine from Automotive Engineering. Thousands of motorists are getting like-new performance with exchange engines installed by the pros at Automotive Engineering. Don't trade away the investment in your American or foreign car. An exchange engine can save you a fortune. And you can save up to $200 this month during the sale at Automotive Engineering.
Automotive Engineering pleases thousands. Why not you?
Spend New Year's Day with us.
For the best live coverage of the 1987 Tournament of Roses Parade.
Thursday morning at 8 on Channel 2.
Good evening. Every New Year's Eve, just like clockwork, calendars fly out windows. Workers in downtown San Francisco threw out the old year today, and tonight at 10, we'll show you the mess.
And President Reagan addressed the Soviet people today in a speech broadcast by Voice of America. Tonight at 10, we'll tell you what Reagan had to say to the Soviets on this last day of 1986. And we'll have more right after this.
Ever ask yourself, how does Pack and Save come up with these same low prices every day? Pack and Save is its own warehouse. We buy in full truckload quantities, and we ship right to our own stores. Then we pass the savings on to you. With the lowest prices on fresh produce, quality meat, poultry, and cheese, and over 20,000 national brands, week after week after week.
It's a whole new way of shopping. Pack and Save.
The choice is yours, and so are the savings.
The head chef at Spenger's Fish Grotto in Berkeley was found stabbed to death behind the restaurant this morning. Tonight at 10, the full story.
Also at 10, all the New Year's Eve resolutions being made, and a look back at the news stories that had the biggest impact on 1986. I'm Dennis Richmond.
And I'm Elaine Corral. We'll have those stories, all the news, tonight on the 10 o'clock news.
Self-Service Furniture's lowest furniture prices of the year. Every item reduced. Every living room, every dining room and bedroom, every lamp, chair, desk, and wall unit. All reduced up to 50% off. To cap the record year at Self-Service Furniture, we're going right off the sales chart. We're after $1 million a day for 6 days. And we've got the prices to do it. Year-end 6-day blowout blitz ends 5 p.m. December 31st at Self-Service Furniture.
There's an authentic cafe-style espresso that you can brew right in your own coffee maker, right in your own home. S&W's new Il Classico. Taste the finer things in life every day.
This is the place to be New Year's Day for the most exciting live coverage of the 1987 Tournament of Roses Parade. We'll bring you the big picture and all the detail from the best camera locations, with Bob Eubanks and Stephanie Edwards to bring you the inside information. And we never leave for commercials. Our Emmy Award-winning coverage has had the biggest audiences for more than 10 years. This year, experience the 1987 Tournament of Roses Parade.
Thursday morning at 8 on Channel 2.
Hocus Pocus, Bullwinkle. We're on.
What other show has a host who sings, dances, recites poetry, and has antlers? On this network, anyway. But I suppose you're wondering why I called you all here this evening. Well, this is why. It's the Bullwinkle Show.
Well, there's no turning back now. There really is going to be a game between the Mud City Manglers and the Wasamata U Pigeons.
What's more, Bullwinkle is now our quarterback.
And what's more, these are the diagrams of the plays we're going to play.
And what's more, they're the wrong diagrams.
Yes, Burris had switched diagrams, and the hapless Moose was now going over a set of battle plans of the Civil War.
Or as we call it, the war between the states.
Now, wait a minute, who are you?
Colonel Jefferson Beauregard Leeser.
Yeah, but you're not part of our story.
No, I'm from the League of Confederate Correctors.
The League of Confederate Correctors?
Every time a program refers to the late unpleasantness as a civil war.
You show up and correct them?
That's right, Shug. We call it the war between the states.
Yeah, but...
I just can't abide the word civil.
Meanwhile, in the locker room of the Mud City Manglers...
Remember, if any of your opponents walks off the field under his own power, it means 20 lashes. All right, men, and I use the term loosely, take the field.
The team's lined up, and Wasamata kicked to the Manglers. Instantly, there was a huddle, and when it broke up, nobody appeared to have the ball.
Who are we supposed to tackle?
Come on, which of you girls has the ball?
What do you think I am, a rat?
You got it, lady.
And before the astonished crowd, the Manglers strolled innocently down the field past the baffled Wasamata players. Then as they reached the goal line, one of the scoundrels pulled the deflated ball from under his mini-blouse.
Touchdown!
Touchdown! Touchdown!
Any objections, wise guy?
Miss, I'll thank you to keep a civil tongue in your head.
A war between the states tongue.
Oh, boy.
Now, wait, Mr. Referee. Did that really count 6 points?
Well, of course not, Rocky. It counted 7 points.
Well, with the referee intimidated, the Manglers had it all their own way.
Hup!
Pass it, Bullwinkle! Ollie!
Oop!
Incomplete, incomplete.
The pass?
The ball.
Are you ready, Gertrude?
Let's have it, Sybil.
War between
I said Sybil, not civil.
Sorry, Maya.
Play the game, play the game.
It was easier said than done.
We're close enough to try a little field goal, Bullwinkle. Just kick it between the goalposts.
Right, Rock. Hop!
The kick looked good until two Manglers moved the goalposts.
At this rate, we'll never win.
We'll be lucky to lose.
But on the next play...
Bullwinkle, look at this!
Good heavens, Rock! You've scalped the scat bag!
Scalp nothing! This is a wig! Bullwinkle, they aren't girls at all!
Oh, darn.
What's the matter?
I was gonna ask the halfback to the prom tonight.
Well, anyway, it's our ball.
Yeah, but look at that defensive line.
Hokey smoke, they've dug trenches.
And they've all got guns.
Mr. Referee, how about calling a penalty?
Oh, I will, Rocky. 5 yards against Wasamata for delaying the game.
Don't you have any courage?
Yes, but I've also got a wife and kiddies.
And with a score 7-0, the hands of the clock crept closer to the feet for our boys and triumph for Boris Badenov. Don't miss our next episode, Bullwinkle's Battle Plans or Civil Def...
War between the states defense.
That is not funny.
I know. I can't abide jokes, neither.
A lot of people have wanted to make it into a feature film, but I think Jay Ward feels that you can't go back. And I agree with him as far as animation and writing is concerned. However, there is interest in live action. I know some very big studios are interested in a Boris and Natasha series or a Dudley and Nell series because Dudley and Nell were such ingenuous people and really delightful. Stupid, but delightful.
In the northern region of Canada, at the close of the 19th century, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police held fast to their tradition of we always get our man. Bleak, cold, lonely. Not a pretty place for a high-spirited girl like Nell Fenwick, daughter of Inspector Fenwick, commander of the post.
You, Dudley Do-Right's horse, are the only one who understands me. You know the longing, the boredom. If only once the Mounties would not get their man. If only once Dudley Do-Right would do wrong like some other men do. I need bright lights, laughter, gaiety. What I'm saying, horse, is that I want to go into show business.
But Nell, you know how your father feels about show business.
Oh, why don't you go out and bring in a man or something?
Very well.
Realizing that her father would never allow her to go into show business, Nell put on a mask and left the camp.
All right, where the Wheel of Fortune stops, nobody knows. Next contestant, please. Name, please.
I am the masked Ginny Lynn.
Go ahead, Miss Lynn. Rather unusual voice quality, boss. I'll say this is our chance to go straight again. Look, they're all sound asleep. Keen. You have just won the Major Snidely Amateur Hour. You get the grand tour with all expenses paid.
It's the Master.
So Snidely with his masked Jenny Lind swept the country. No town escaped the ruthless masked singer.
I really knocked him out in Toronto, eh?
Meanwhile, a man from one of the ravished towns wandered into the mounted police camp.
And, Inspector, you should hear this masked Jenny Lind. Hoo-wee!
Pretty square, eh?
Like the squarest.
Don't worry. As you know, the Canadian Mounties always get a man. You see, here comes a mountain now.
Nell! I did as you said. I got my man.
Dudley, how many times have I got to tell you? This is a dog. This is a man.
Oh, all right. You're under arrest.
No. Not this man. Oh, well, never mind.
This is about the squarest Mountie I've ever seen.
That's right, sir. Square shooting Dudley Do-Right at your service.
Dudley, how do you feel about Lawrence Welk?
Only terrific, Inspector. That's real toe-tapping music.
I thought so. Dudley, I have a little job for you. You are the only Mountie square enough to carry it off.
That's me, Inspector. Square and true, eyes of blue.
I want you to bring in the masked Jenny Lind. And I know you can do it because...
Ta-da!
The Mounties always get their men.
But this is a woman, sir.
Go do right.
And so one night in Saskatchewan...
Snidely, there's a Mountie out there in the audience.
Mountie, huh? Listen, baby, I want you to go out there and sing like you have never sung before. This'll put him to sleep. Did you put in the curtain, Barney?
Yeah.
Okay, then draw the curtain.
Oh, sing it, baby. Mama's little baby lamb shortening, shortening. Oh, don't do, 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 do.
Snidely, he ain't sleeping.
Well, then what's he doing?
He's enjoying it.
Oh, turn off the lights and call the law right now. Do-de-do-do-do-do-do. Miss Lee and I certainly do enjoy your singing, but, well, you see, I am a Mountie, square and true. So I really
Dudley,
must...
Dudley, I thought I told you to go bring in a man.
Nell, then you're the masked Jenny Lind.
Surprise.
So Dudley brought Nell, Snidely, and Barney back to the Royal Canadian Mounted Police Camp.
Well, Dudley, you finally did it. You brought in your man, Snidely Whiplash, the most wanted man in the territory of this glorious nation. But tell me, where's the masked Jenny Lind?
Inspector, just wait till you hear her sing. She's a little old Florence Nightingale, that's what. And here she is, your own daughter, Nell.
Nell? I knew there was something missing around here. You mean, Nell, it was you?
You know, Father, how you've always held me back. Well, I got my break at last. I'm in showbiz. I'm a star. Just listen. Dee 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 dee.
Oh, sing that thing. Shorten, shorten. Mama's little baby love shorten. Mama's little baby love shortening bread. Sorry.
And now.
Hey, Rocky, watch me pull a rabbit out of my hat.
Again?
Open up my sleeve. Presto! No doubt about it. I gotta get another hat.
Now here's something we hope you'll really like.
Once upon a time, in a little pond in the Middle West, lived an ugly duckling who wanted to be a movie star.
I ought to be in pictures! Da 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 da!
He was the star of his local dramatic club, and he was written up in his hometown newspaper for his acting in Cyrano de Duckerac, Hamlet, the Melancholy Duck, and Duck of a Salesman. But this kind of fame meant nothing to him. He wanted to be a movie star.
I'm just ripe for some lucky scout to discover.
So the ugly duckling left his little pond and journeyed far away to a place where all the big talent scouts came to scout talent, a place called Schwab's Swamp. All around him were pictures of the ducks who had been discovered there.
Duck Benny, Duck Jones, Duck Rogers. Gee, even Duck Tracy.
And sure enough, talent scouts were discovering ducks all around him.
Hey, you.
Me?
No, him. Sign here.
Hey, handsome.
Yes?
Not you, ugly. Him. Will 1,000 a week be enough?
But alas, nobody wanted to discover the ugly duckling.
Ugly? Gosh, looks like I'm a has-been before I was even a was.
My, for a duck, you are certainly a silly goose.
What do you mean?
You can't just sit there and wait for them. Make them discover you.
By golly, I'd do it.
Soon, the ugly duckling was standing before one of the biggest producers in town, J.B. Hogfat himself.
Now get this, J.B. Don't you see, Captain? There's no time now. We're thinking of women and children. You're the only one who can get through safely. Go, take your last boat. I will stay and keep the ship off the rocks. Don't think of me. I've lived my life thinking of children.
Magnificent. Oh, you're a great actor, Duck.
Then I get a contract?
Of course not. You're ugly as a mud fence, but you were superb.
Yeah, that figures.
The ugly duckling tried and tried.
Now, my little pigeon, come with me to this swamp.
No.
In its dark, mysterious byways, you will come to know the ways of love, l'amour.
Doc, you are greatest lover in world.
But...
You ugly.
No soap.
No soap.
Still, the duckling didn't give up.
Such grace, such rhythm. Another Astaire, a new Gene Kelly.
But I'm too ugly for a contract, eh?
Oh, much too.
Thought so.
And it was the same story with everyone he saw.
Gracious, you are an ugly one.
Cab, please.
Yes, Ugg. Yes, sir.
Hey, mister.
Yes?
How come you're so ugly?
All right, I get the idea.
Broken-hearted, the duck returned to Schwab's swamp.
It's no use. I got a face that would stop a clock, even an electric clock.
Oh, you silly goose. You give up so easily. Haven't you ever heard of facelifting?
I don't want it higher. I want it prettier.
Then go to a plastic surgeon. Get your beak bobbed. Your feathers lifted. Get handsome.
Yes, I'll do it.
So, several weeks later, at the hospital...
I have good news for you, my boy. Today the bandages come off.
Hurry, Doc. I've got to know.
You're lovely.
It's true. You are good looking.
It was true. The doctor had done the trick. Without wasting a minute, the handsome duckling dashed back to the producer's office.
Well, here I am, J.B. Just slip the contract under here. I'll just sign it. I won't even read it.
What do you talk? I won't give you a contract.
Why?
You're too blame good looking.
Too?
Well, it seemed as if the trend in movie making had switched to horror pictures. The thing in the duck pond. It ducked from outer space. Ugly duck meets Wolfman.
Sorry, bud, I can't use any good lookers. Excuse me. Hello, Myron. Yeah, me too. But there was a duck here last week who'd be perfect for the part.
Me? It was me.
Faced like 3 days of bad weather.
My face?
I told you once, no more pretty boys. Now, Myron, if he shows up again, I'll make a star out of him.
And so the little duckling realized that he had left his real happiness back in that little pond in the middle. Hey, now, wait a minute. You're not going back.
Of course not. I'm just starting my new job. Okay, you guys, let her go.
Why are you...
I figure in a week I'll be ugly enough to scare anybody. But meanwhile, I'm still in show business.
In our last episode, you remember, Wassamata's football future looked very dim. First, Boris Badenov's Mud City Manglers had intimidated the referee.
Intimidated? Heck, I'm terrified.
Then they had turned their defensive game into trench warfare, complete with barbed wire and gun emplacements. And to make matters even worse, Boris had stolen all of Wassamata's plays.
Natasha, now I think I'll take up smoking cigars.
Why now?
So I can light one with these football plays.
Other people use a $100 bill, darling.
Right now, these are worth a million.
Yes, they were, for Boris had made hundreds of bets on the game in illegal gambling joints all over the nation.
Hey, Manny, it looks like that girl's team is going to beat Wassamata you.
Don't worry, Lefty. I'm prepared.
You're going to pay off?
You kidding? You see that emergency box on the wall?
In case of disaster, break glass. What's inside, money?
Nope, a one-way ticket to Brazil.
At that moment, the referee raised his pistol to signify the end of the first half. Lying flat on the ground, our heroes were safe momentarily, but the spectators in the end zone didn't make out as well.
Manny, the Mud City Manglers just shot away the end of the stadium. What do you say to that?
Adios, amigos. Boom chicka boom chicka boom 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 chicka boom chicka boom chicka boom boom boom.
When our heroes finally made it under fire to their dressing room, gloom was written on every face.
Except mine. I got despair written on mine.
If only they hadn't stolen our football plays.
Well, they left these in their place.
But Bullwinkle, those aren't football plays. Those are battle plans for the Civil War.
War between the states, you mean?
Colonel Beauregard, you here?
Us members of the League of Confederate Correctors is everywhere.
I've noticed.
I just can't abide the word civil.
Well, here, maybe you'd like to have these plans.
My pleasure. Ah, Chancellorsville. There was a battle. What a cavalry charge.
Looks more like an end run to me.
Bullwinkle, that's it. If the Manglers are going to use battle tactics on the gridiron, why can't we?
Why can't we?
Bullwinkle, you've done it again.
Come up with a brilliant plan and like that.
Yes, sir.
Now, there's just that one little question.
Yeah?
What is it?
This is the plan. Instead of football plays, we're going to use the battle plans of the... I was going to say war between the states.
Us Confederate correctors can never be too sure.
And so when the whistle blew for the second half of the game, it was a strange-looking team that emerged from the Wasamata U dressing room.
Look at them fellas, Roof. They going to fight the war all over again.
Shucks, we Southerners been doing that for years.
The ball was snapped and Bullwinkle commanded.
By the right flag, ho!
Started up again, but this time the Mud City Manglers were no match for the military genius of the flower of the Confederacy. In one great flanking motion, the Wasamata team turned the end of the line and swept down the field.
Bullwinkle, you did it! There's the goal, just ahead! Hey! Bullwinkle, why are you stopping?
Which direction are we running in, Corporal?
Well, south, of course.
South, eh? I thought so. These plans call for us to go north.
And Bullwinkle turned and began dashing toward his own goal line. On he went, swivel-hipping his way through the opposition.
Dagnabbit, you said civil.
All right, war between the states, hipping his way through the opposition. Oh, what can save the game for our boys?
Maybe we could get some new writers.
Don't miss our next historical episode, Bullwinkle Buys a Fence, or Pickett's Charge.
That's a pretty strange-looking painting, Bullwinkle.
I just paint what I see.
Well, what do you see?
This is what I see.
Please stay tuned for the most amazing TV jewelry offer in Poole's Fifth Avenue history. Right now, in a $1 million publicity campaign to gain new friends, Poole's is giving away this exclusive designer heirloom collection featuring an exquisite commemorative two-ring set blazing with more than 2 carats of fiery faux diamonds and layered and genuine 14-carat gold. Plus this magnificent set of 4 heavy French rope chains, all layered in 14-karat gold. Plus these tritone rings and these tritone bangles layered in 14-karat gold. Plus these beautiful faux diamond stud earrings and this stunning solitaire necklace, all yours in this incredible publicity campaign from Poole's. But you don't pay $17,000 or even $1,700, because if you're one of the first 1,000 people to call right now, we'll send you all 17 pieces of jewelry for just $17 complete. The designer heirloom collection featuring the magnificent commemorative two-ring set, 4 heavy French rope chains, 3 tritone rings, 6 tritone bangle bracelets, and the faux diamond earrings and necklace, all layered in genuine 14-karat gold, all for just $17 complete on our money-back guarantee of satisfaction. But you must order now.
Get all 17 pieces for just $17. COD and credit card orders, call 1-800-243-2600. That's 1-800-243-2600. To save COD fees, use your credit card or send $17 plus $2 postage to 17-piece jewelry, 200 West 7th Street, Suite 618, Fort Worth, Texas. Offer is limited to the first 1,000 callers who call now, 1-800-243-2600.
One memorable night.
Thanks, Rob.
At the Silver Bullet.
Hey, you're Don Adams, right?
Yes. One Coors Light, please.
Would you believe? 2 Coors Lights.
Great.
Ring, ring. Hello? It's for you, Don.
Terrific.
Ah, thanks. Mind if I join you?
Mind if I pour?
Not at all. Missed it by that much.
There's no slowing down with the Silver Bullet tonight.
Just did.
Ford fever is hot, and the world's hottest-selling car is moving fast. The new Ford Escort GT has arrived, with 3.9% financing. It won't last long. This offer will be gone January 4th.
You're watching Bullwinkle's New Year's special on KTVU's 8 o'clock movie special.
It's hip to be square.
Music stirs you up. Music shakes you out. Music takes hold of you, and when it's good, it doesn't let go of you. The Columbia Record and Tape Club can help you get a lot more music. Just find our ad. It's in your Sunday paper. Pick any 12 records or tapes for a penny and see how to get even more music free. Huey Lewis and the News, Cyndi Lauper, Genesis, Lionel Richie, hundreds more. All the music you love. The Columbia Record and Tape Club. No one else gives you so much for so little. 12 albums, 1 cent. Find our ad in Sunday's paper. Take it to your mailbox. You'll get a lot more music. You'll get a lot more life. Look in your Sunday paper. Cats, the number one musical in America. Cats, leaving San Francisco January 31st. Cats, see the magic, the mystery, the memory that will live forever. Cats, the winner of 7 Tony Awards. Don't miss this once-in-a-lifetime experience. Get your tickets now for the most exciting family musical ever. Cats at the Golden Gate Theater. To charge, call 1-800-233-3123 now.
If you've been waiting, now is the time. The last 5 days are the best 5 days to buy a new Hyundai at Stevens Creek Hyundai and Hayward's Auto West Hyundai. 150 new Hyundais, all clearance priced. Any red tagged XL is just $49.95 or $89 a month. Any white tagged XL is just $59.95 or $109 a month. Any blue tagged Hyundai is just $69.95 or $129 a month. Pick your car, pick your payment, but only till the 31st and only at Auto West Hyundai Hayward and Stevens Creek Hyundai San Jose. Don't miss it.
The Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders. I want them for the September cover story.
Now, I am not prepared to let anybody do any more hatchet jobs on my girls.
Well, what story? You haven't told me.
I want to cut through all that phony PR and show those girls for what they really are.
Jane Seymour, an undercover reporter, joins the squad to get the truth behind the pom-poms. Bert Convy and Lauren Tooze co-star. The Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders. Sunday at 8 on Channel 2. There's only one, two.
Happy New Year to everyone, except Moose and Squirrel.
You hear is the sobbing of thousands of bookmakers all over the country. For every one of these illegal gamblers bet that unbeaten Wasamata U would trounce a girls' team known as the Mud City Manglers, little realizing that the Manglers were owned by Boris Badenov and had been coached by fearless leader himself.
Hold that line, fellows.
Oh, they won't retreat, Badenov.
How can you be sure?
The second team is right behind them with bayonets.
Huh?
See?
The hapless bookies watched as the Manglers held Wasamata U scoreless for the first half.
I'll never make another bet again as long as I live.
3-1, you do.
You're wrong.
You lose.
Things looked a little brighter for our boys when Rocky decided to play the game according to some old battle plans of the war between the states.
Now you're talking, Yankee.
But even this idea backfired when Bullwinkle decided to take the plan seriously.
But Bullwinkle...
Tunnel moose to you, Corporal.
Oh, boy.
What direction are we heading?
South.
You mean south?
Yes, south. So what?
This here plan says we march north. North it is.
And with flag flying, Bullwinkle began running toward his own goal line.
Again?
Disaster was imminent, but as fate would have it, the clock suddenly marked the end of the quarter.
What's the trouble?
Now the teams change goals. Moose is now running in right direction.
Yes, at that moment, Bullwinkle dashed into the end zone for a touchdown.
Hooray! That's 6 points.
But the referee, who was under some pressure, decided that...
No, only 3 points.
Three?
It's a handicap. After all, you're playing an all-girl team.
You just wouldn't want to take advantage of a lady, would you?
But you're not a lady.
Sir, yous is a cat.
Penalty on the play.
About time. How many yards do we get?
Get? I'm penalizing Wasamata 30 yards, insulting a lady.
Yeah, but that puts us behind our own goal line. That's a touchback.
Right, 3 points for Mud City.
3 points?
They get an extra point for being girls.
Bullwinkle, we can't win.
That's the general idea, Squirtle.
And who are you?
I'm the leader of the all-girl team.
You are?
I'm the field spitalny of the gridiron.
Yeah, but those aren't really girls.
I know that. You know that. But does the referee know that?
Do you know that?
All I know is this fella behind me has a gun aimed right at my 50-yard line.
But, Winkle, that fella's intimidating a referee.
Not very well. He doesn't look like one at all.
No, I mean he's threatening that poor little guy's life.
Well, that does it, Rock. Now my dandruff is up. Give me those battle plans, ladies or no ladies. This is war.
And it was. In the next 10 minutes, Wasamata, you replayed the entire last 2 years of the Civil War.
War between the states.
And this time, the South won.
In that case, you can call it the Civil War.
Yes, just before the final gun sounded, Rocky flashed into the clear. And zoomed for the goal line.
Bullwinkle, pass it to me.
But that was the moment Boris Badenov had been waiting for. He quickly seized a large rock, painted it to look like a football, and hurled it right at the unsuspecting squirrel. Oh, don't miss our next heart-stopping episode, A Rock for Rock, or To Each His Stone.
Over the river and through the woods to Grandmother's house it goes, with a great big basket of goodies and some boxes of Cheerios. Over the river and through the woods with each tasty golden O. The horse knows the way to carry the sleigh.
So it gets upset in the snow.
General Mills was our first sponsor, and they really had no inhibitions about what we said or what we did. And they bought us almost sight unseen, and we're very grateful to them for that.
And here, with his bird's eye view and a brain to match, is Mr. Know-It-All.
Our subject for today is how to be a beatnik. Some people think the beatnik is merely a bum with sunglasses, but he is more than that, though not much. The first step in becoming a beatnik is to grow a beard. This can be a long process, particularly if you're a girl. Clothing-wise, we should remember this important rule. The well-dressed beatnik is seldom neatnik. Beatniks hang out in unemployment lines, health food stores, but most of all, in coffee houses. Beatnik joints have lots of atmosphere, but it's usually too dark to see it.
Coffee, tea, or goat's milk?
Coffee, I guess.
Coffee we got. What kind?
See. Espresso, 75 cents. Cappuccino, 85. Sanko, 50. Refill, 25. Think I'll have some of that there refill.
Why don't you try Cafe Minuto?
Cafe Minuto? What's that?
Instant coffee. Special for you, I make with dirty water. How is?
Terrible.
Good. Should taste bad to last drop.
The beatnik is often fond of reading poetry to jazz. Thusly, Mary had a swinging lamb. He followed her to school. She hocked his wool for a bongo drum, and man, that lamb was cool.
Thank you, Mr. Norlow.
And now for an encore.
And now...
Hey, Rocky, watch me pull a rabbit out of my hat.
But that trick never worked.
This time for sure. Resto! Well, I'm getting close.
And now it's time for another special feature.
Happiness, my boy, is not to be found in borrowed finery.
Is that why you dress up in that old sheet?
This isn't an old sheet, Junior. It's an old toga. And an old toga... Well, as usual, you've missed the whole point of what I'm trying to teach you.
Maybe if you spelled it out for me, Pop?
All right, Junior. Now, hand me that scroll over there. Yeah, that's it. There now. Now, let me see. When we left Little Orphan Annie, she and Daddy Warbuck were... Junior, you haven't handed me the scroll. You've handed me your comic book. Now, let's get with it, lad, huh? Now then, once upon a time...
Pop.
Yes, son?
Do you think fables will ever replace TV?
Now, let me continue with the story. Once upon a time, there was this crow.
Tell me, man, are you going to be a crow all your life?
Well, I have not given it much thought.
You know, like, I'm sick of being a crow. I'm sick of going around in the same old tired black suit. Sick, sick, sick. You know what I'm going to be?
Well, I have not given it much thought.
I'm going to be a peacock. Man, those crazy colors. You know why the peacock has such a gorgeous tail?
Well, I have not given it much thought.
It's the chicks, man, the chicks. He just flashes that old tail and all those crazy cuckoo colors show up. And those chicks, they really flip. Yes, sir, that's what I'm going to be. I'm going to be a peacock.
Of course.
You haven't given it much thought. Yeah, I know.
Yeah. But tell me, how can a crow become a peacock? I mean, don't you have to be born that way, peacock-wise, bat ears?
Like I've been telling you, it's the tail, man. It's the tail. All you got to do is get some of them wild, multicolored feathers and look out, chicks, because your big daddy is in town. Ooh-ooh-ba-doo-scaw-scaw-bidaw, you turn out the lights and you call the law. Hey, man, like, where can I pick up on some of them crazy feathers you cats carry around to impress the chicks?
Oh, I've really got a live one this time. Let me see. You'd like to purchase the colorful tail, is that it?
Oh, Daddy, you are reading me loud and clear. What I mean, I want a tail that is the living end.
Well, I think we can fix you up. Let me see. You seem to be a size 34 to me. Listen, you know that old feather duster we have around here?
Yeah, boss.
Well, stick it in some paint. This crow will buy anything.
Is this it? I mean, this is the real thing. A real peacock tail?
The real thing.
Well, you just watch my dust.
Just watch your duster.
Oh, now that I've got a peacock's tail, why should I fool around with crows, just black crows? From now on, it is bigger game. Why not the real thing, like peacocks? Pardon me, ma'am, but are there any more at home like you?
Well, yes. But I doubt if there are any more at home like you. And if there are, I certainly hope they stay there.
Man, I was doing all right until that sudden snowstorm. Strange, you know, a snowstorm in July. Gad, free moke, what weather. I had better go home and put on a muffler. Oh, George, I believe I'm catching a cold. This unseasonable weather. Like, wow.
Not a bad-looking crow. But what's he doing bundled up like that in July? Hey, he must be some kind of a kook.
Like, good afternoon, dearie. Better stand back. I've got me a very nasty cold.
Listen, I just thought you were a harmless nut. But if you're going to accost young ladies with your stupid practical jokes, I'm afraid...
Practical jokes? Please, lady, I'm not a joker. I'm a peacock.
Police!
Yes, lady. Hey, is this nut bothering you?
Well, I was just walking down the street, minding my own business, when this creep comes up.
All right, Buster. Move along.
But, Mr. Brass, sir, it's you two are the nuts, dressed like you are in weather like this. Like you're going to catch your death of cold.
Wait a minute, buddy. At the present time, it's 94 degrees in the shade. Now move along.
But you don't understand. I'm a peacock.
That is it. It's the cope for you.
So poor crow languished in the clink for impersonating a peacock for a long, long time. So long, in fact, that all of the feathers fell out of his tail, or his feather duster. But he was released on good behavior.
Man, you know what I'm going to be?
Well, I have not given it much thought.
A stork. Man, I'm going to get me a pair of stilts. I'm going to be 9 feet tall. You know, the chicks really dig them tall birds. Man, I'm going to get those old sticks, and I'm going to walk me up a storm.
And so you see, son, old Crow never did learn his lesson, which just goes to show...
that the moral of this fable is very feeble.
Huh?
You know, Pop...
How's that, son?
I don't think fables will ever replace TV.
In our last quarter of the episode, our heroes were right on the verge of winning their game with the Mud City Manglers, or losing it, as the case may be. For Rocky the Flying Squirrel had just zoomed into the clear of the goal line and shouted back at Bullwinkle...
The forward pass, Bullwinkle! Ollie!
Oop! But the oop had come from Boris Badenov, who had thrown not a football, but a cleverly disguised rock.
Would you like a nice squirtle coat, fearless leader?
You got one, Badenov?
No, but I know somebody who won't be needing one in a minute.
But let us stop everything right here and change our scene to an emergency meeting of the Bookmakers and Gamblers Protective Association.
Fellow bookies, I would like to take advantage of this brief moment to remind you of our untenable position.
A what?
A lousy setup.
Oh.
Look, the squirrel is going to get clobbered, right?
Right.
Now, if he loses the game, we got to pay off the Badenov, right?
Right.
Wrong. There ain't enough money in the world to pay off at the odds we gave him.
So what do we do, skip town?
Would I suggest a cheap trick like skipping town?
Sorry, Mickey.
I suggest we skip the country.
Yeah. Where do we go?
Yeah. Who'd want crooks like us?
Follow me, boys. I know a country that'll take anybody.
But the villains had reckoned without the keen eyes and instant reflexes of our furry hero.
Hokey smokes, that's not a football.
And Rocky's swift referee zipped to one side. The heavy stone passed him and plummeted right for the timid referee, who still had a gun held at his back by one of Boris's thugs.
Duck! Duck!
Hey, what's he mean, duck, duck?
Maybe there's a flock of them coming over.
Hey, that ain't no flock of ducks. That's a rock.
But where's Bullwinkle?
You cold?
Yes, out of the pall and smoke and flame that covered the gridiron galloped Bullwinkle Moose, the football dangling from his antlers.
Quick, Bullwinkle! There's only a few seconds left.
Now, what do we do, Badenoff?
Relax, fearless leader.
Relax?
Shoe, Mike. Look at this diagram of the end zone.
What are the circles?
Landmines. I've mined the whole end zone.
Explosive landmines in a football field? Badenoff, that's a rotten thing to do.
I just knew you would like it, fearless leader.
Boris, I like to have you around. You're my kind of folks.
Could I call you FL?
I'm on my way up, Boris, and I'm going to take you with me.
But alas for the villain's plans. Bullwinkle dashed into the end zone, turned and galloped all the way across it, and didn't step on one mine.
Touchdown.
Yay!
6 points.
Wassamata wins!
Yay!
So, you had landmines in the end zone, eh, Badenoff?
I can't understand it, fearless leader. I could swear I had one, right? You were right, fearless leader. You're on the way up, and I'm going with you.
And so, Wassamata, you finished its season unbeaten.
Only one fly in the ointment, Bullwinkle.
Well, that's about par for ointment. What is it?
I didn't like all those gamblers escaping to some other country.
Ah, if Rocky had only known the bookie's boat was even then approaching its destination.
Well, there it is, man. Pottsylvania.
And look, there's a reception committee to meet us. Hey, Charlie, if I ever get you 10, we goofed. Bet heavily, Schweinhorn. It's a sure thing.
And so we come to the end of another fun-filled episode of Rocky and Bullwinkle.
You know, Rock, he sure got some funny ideas about fun.
Toth News Agency felt that we were perpetuating the Cold War. And Rocky and Natasha were dubbed into Japanese and shown over in Tokyo. And the Russians naturally are closer to Japan than they are here, and they were monitoring it, and they said, "Net, you can't do that." And so they really raised quite a hullabaloo in Tokyo, and they were taken off for a while, but then they went back on. And I don't care whether it's Russia or the United States or what country it is. We've got to learn to laugh at ourselves, and that's what we did on the Bullwinkle Show.
Sci-fi adventure.